And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1 p.m. Stay tuned next for your own health and fitness.
Welcome to your own health and fitness. I'm Lena Berman. Jeffrey Fawcett and I come to you weekly with a critical, independent voice on the politics and practice of health and the environment. Most dietary experts, even the less conventional ones like Michael Pollan, Andrew Weil, Michael Murphy, and there are many others, fail to discuss how individual food and nutrient needs are. There are so many considerations: gut health, food allergies, sensitivities, blood sugars. Even traditional approaches examine whether the terrain, sort of the state of health of an individual, needs to be stimulated or calmed, whether the terrain is hot or cold, dry or moist. How is the gut functioning, for example, before you suggest loading up on probiotics? Should this particular person avoid milk-based products? Do the much-praised prebiotics like FOS and Indulin cause gastric distress? And can they be eliminated by taking probiotics without them with food? Think of chocolate. It's got all these antioxidants. It's got happy chemicals. Is it for everybody? What about people with herpes? Chocolate and nuts are very high in arginine, and they will usually trigger an attack. What about the caffeine in chocolate? Is that for everybody? Sometimes you have to consider, for instance, the fact that chocolate is very heating. So while that might be wonderful on a cold day for a cold person, for somebody who is inflamed and tends to be hot in general, maybe not chocolate. So under what conditions should foods be used, and how can they be balanced for their different characteristics? Another consideration is, do you know where your food comes from? If you buy fun processed foods like smoothie mixes or pancake mixes, so-called paleo pancake mixes, chips, protein and bone broth powders, cereals, baked goods, bars, all these drinks, all these things, all in the center of the food aisle, in the center aisle of the food store. Even the ones that are labeled organic. Are they free of pesticides? All the pesticides, including glyphosates? What about the water that they use in processing them? Where are all the materials from? Are powdered bone broth soups from pastured animals, or are they from industrially raised feedlots? Has the food, again, been tested for glyphosates? Not really happening so much here. And as you know, glyphosates and fluoride are in water supplies all over the place. Is your food coming from the Central Valley, which we know is very, very polluted? So, you know, again, if you're processing these powders with high heat, that tends to denature and change the proteins. It tends to damage fats if there are fats in it. So there are all these questions, and there are more that make these convenient foods — these are convenience foods, huh? Well, it makes them less convenient. The closer you are to the source of your food, the better the nutrient quality and the safety. Not only is it safer to shop at farmers markets because you can develop a relationship with these farmers, and if you trust them and know them, you know what kind of practices they're doing, or signing up for a CSA with a local farmer, or even raising some of your own food. It has been done. But geez, how about unprocessed convenience foods like, for instance, whole foods, whole fruits, vegetables, cheese, nuts, boiled eggs. Join me today in this hour for Confusion, It's What's for Dinner. So what I'm going to attempt to do today is not, you know, I'm going to miss some issues here. Somebody is going to write me an email and say, well, what about this? So this is going to be time permitting. We'll see how far I get. But the idea here is what I'm trying to do is not tell you what to do. What I'm trying to do is give you some principles that you can use as a template over what you're doing. So you can think through what you're doing with some principles. One principle is when you're thinking about what you need to eat, remember that you change throughout life. You as you age and grow and develop or become, God forbid, or somebody forbid, disabled in any way or anything is affecting you, things change through life, including just the normal aging process. And so with that, things that worked for you before may not work in the same way. And also remember that, as far as I can tell, everything works for somebody. You know, it's sort of like that, even a broken clock, you know, is right one time a day. Well, my observation is that some people can eat all kinds of funny diets, things that don't seem rational to me, that seem to work for them, how long it works for them, whether their bodies change as you go along, who knows. But this is not about, is this good, is this bad? I mean, short of toxins and pesticides and industrially raised foods, the issue of whether one food or another is good or bad is not so important as who you are and what you need. So, you know, the principle here, again, is using your body as a laboratory. Your body, not someone else's body, your body. Most dietary suggestions, in my experience, are way too general. Just way too general. So I always think when I hear them, for whom? Under what circumstances? Science can be a guide. Research and studies can reveal some interesting things, but you must remember that studies and conclusions can be set up and written to support anything the designers of the research believe in. So, you know, it's confusing when somebody like Michael Pollan, who seems very rational and centrist and, you know, kind of inclusive, starts criticizing science as reductionistic and then proceeds to use recent research for his recommendations without considering, once again, who are you? Who is he recommending this to? Under what circumstances? Again, the overriding principle. Who are you? What works for you? What do you expect from your body? How do you want it to perform? What do you want to be able to do? And then, of course, what are your values? What's your value system? And what have you got to work with? Everybody has different resources to work with. They have different energy, their time, your time considerations, the resources that you have around you, you know, your income and various things, and your stress level are all going to change how you make up your mind about what to do, including your proclivities. You know, are you a people person? Are you a solo? All this stuff. It's all considerations. Now, when I talk about what you have to work with, notice that I'm not talking about genetics. Genetics is affected by the environment. And in the same way, you can come from a family line, for instance. You inherit your mitochondrial function, your energy capacity and energy cell function from your mother and your grandmother. So if you look back and you can tell that both your mother and your grandmother were tired all the time. That doesn't mean that that's all there is for you. That's what you're stuck with. Remember that changing your environment, changing the stimulus in your environment, can change the outcome to what you have to work with. It can be worked with. Some other considerations, obviously, are how's your heart? Is your blood pressure high? What are your blood sugars? Very important. How's your mood? How's your mobility? How's your gut? If you do have a problem with chronic illness or disability, use that as a way to, again, these are things to work with, not to stop you. Above all, I would say, limiting and eliminating exposures that may be affecting you and your children, like toxins in the food. And a reminder here, Jeffrey just did a really interesting interview with Dr. Pero, P-E-R-O, who wrote a book about toxins in children, because she's been working in this area, and that means that she's uncovered some things about glyphosates that people haven't been talking about, like the fact that obviously they're in everything now. It's in everything. It's in the water. It's in the soil. I mean, it's really rampant. So it's really hard to isolate things to be sure that you're not getting glyphosates. And that means that even whole food and organically labeled may have glyphosates in them. And it gets very tricky when you start buying from farmers who are using, for instance, you can get compost that's produced by large industrial entities. You know, they take yard waste from people that are recycling and they turn it into compost. And I don't think anybody is testing. Nobody is, that's right, when I've asked, nobody is testing to see whether those composts have glyphosates in them. They do check sometimes in, and this is also organically labeled fertilizers for organic growing. Also, they're labeled organic, but when you ask some pointed questions, you'll find out that, in fact, the source material is not organic. It's industrial. It's often industrially raised animals, or if it's a vegetarian amendment, it's going to be coming from kelp and soy, and the soy may be a GMO, and the kelp may be radiated. So how far do they test? I notice that some organic fertilizers will do metal testing, and you'll notice that they do have metals in them, but how much and what are you willing to do? So in the end, you know, the closed loop sort of raising food where you've got a closed loop and you know where everything is coming from would be the best. But short of that, knowing who you're getting food from and also occasionally maybe growing some of your own food is going to really affect how much you're getting exposure to. Now, that said, Dr. Pero has observed that when people switch to eating all organic, which has been a question because it's expensive to do that, but does it make a difference? And in her observation, it does. It makes a difference. The kids get better. People get better, healthier. So limiting exposures. So age, geez, can't really do much to stop that. But what you can do is note that it isn't limiting as much as it needs consideration, like all these other things that you have to work with. Getting older, and I mean older, it's going to hit different people at different times, I think. People are considered elderly at 65. Some people feel just great at 65. Sometimes they feel great on and on and on until very close to the time when they're actually passing out of this world. But as you get past, you know, maybe between 65 and 70, most people, I think, notice that recovery slows down, repair slows down. There's a need, I think, for more protein because protein is for repair. But there's also something tricky about, as you get older, it appears that your gut, your tummy, doesn't tolerate overfilling. If you overeat, it really upsets your stomach. So people notice that they are eating maybe smaller meals. But then if you're eating smaller meals and what you're doing is craving a lot of carbohydrates instead of getting some protein in there, it's going to affect how well you recover, since protein of any source is about recovery and rebuilding and repair. So everything, again, is going to be about, particularly when you get older, is going to be about your balance of what you're doing, how well you keep things, how well you notice how you're functioning at different levels and what keeps your balance, you know, including your cardio function and your muscle strength and exercising so that you keep those things up, that you are training in balance. You may be walking on uneven ground. You're working your hearts and lungs, not to the point of exhaustion, but to the point where you notice you're actually getting a training effect and obviously strengthening your muscles. You know, I'm all about that. So the body keeps responding as far as I can tell. I certainly observed it in my parents as they got older. And then, you know, this I think this is nonsense, this thing about that you should be heavier as you get older, because if you start having some health problems and you're starting to lose weight, you won't last as long. Well, honestly, if that's happening, I don't want to last that long, but I don't know about you, get to decide. But there's equal and very compelling research about calorie restriction, not to the point where you're hungry and you're not getting the nutrients you need. You don't have to be a lunatic about this, but it looks as though people who stay slender and who don't overeat actually can live longer. So a reminder, you're listening to Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm Lena Berman, and I'm talking to you alone about what I'm calling confusion. It's what's for dinner. It's about some principles for and some considerations for you to think through how to eat and what things might make dietary suggestions good for you or might make them totally inappropriate. Incidentally, if you do grow your own food, I have discovered to my dismay, although I'm glad I did it, that testing your soil is really a good idea, because soil is like the human body. It needs a balance, a very delicate balance of minerals and nitrogen. And you could just be, you know, putting in all these nitrogen increasing things and forgetting about your minerals, and then you're having trouble growing things. And it may just be a question of getting your soil tested, and the pH tested might straighten that out. So let's look at how to assess your situation. Anyone who's listened to me over the years knows that you will know some of this stuff already, but just to go over it again, and then also anybody who knows anything about me knows that I'm going to say something about wireless in every single show I do, because it's the miracle of the moment, and it's giving our lives, it's enriching our lives in so many ways, and there's a complete disconnect about how long we lived without this and how well we did without it. We now know, despite the fact that the NTP sort of study, the federally funded study, they sort of, someone got to them. And so they backed down on how strongly they said what they said. But anybody examining the conclusions, people who are now writing about it, including the very good article in The Nation magazine, terrific article, wireless tech, at the very least, is extremely inflammatory. It increases your stress response all over your body. It's inflaming cells that, in the NTP study, became cancerous, which are cells that are all over your body. And when they get inflamed, you are looking at autoimmune diseases, neurological diseases, mood disorders, and cancer all over the place. Blood pressure, heart symptoms, blood pressure go up. Exposed to wireless, your sleep, your capacity for recovery goes down. So when you're assessing yourself, it's worth assessing your exposures, and including wireless tech. And remember, we all lived without these things for a long time, and it really isn't that hard to do. And you may find that you feel better if you can at least within your own life reduce or eliminate the obvious exposures that you have a choice about. All right, on to other forms of self-assessment. One important thing to do is to note how you feel after a meal. Now, obviously, if you eat a large meal, you may feel a little bit sleepy afterwards, but if you eat a moderate-sized meal and you feel really sleepy afterwards, like really like you're falling asleep, or you feel bloated afterwards, you may be dealing with some food addictions, some food allergies. You may have sugar addictions. You also can note whether or not your hands and feet are cold, or whether they're hot, in fact, so heating, cooling. Your skin, is it dry? Is it oily? Your energy level, how is that? What's your resting pulse like? And then what's it like after a meal? Do your pulse and blood pressure go up after eating? Do they stay up? That might be an indication that you've eaten something you're sensitive to. So generally speaking, your stress level, your activity level, whether or not you're dealing with illness, your body weight and size and composition, because you can be a large person with lots of muscle. And the size is less important than the composition. And then really important, not discussed enough, is your blood sugars. And it's actually pretty easy to check your blood sugars. First of all, these days, most people know someone with a blood sugar testing kit. So many people are diabetic. But my impression is that those kits are not terribly expensive and that you can order them without a prescription. Yeah, that's correct. I'm getting confirmation over here. So, you know, it might be reasonable to buy an inexpensive blood. It's a little thing that pokes your finger, which after you do it the first time is ridiculously easy and not an issue. And then you put it onto some paper that you insert into this little piece of equipment that's smaller than a cell phone. And it's battery operated and it will measure blood sugars. And that's a good tool because if your blood sugars are over 100 after meals, 2 hours after meals, first thing in the morning, that's going to mean that you're going to want to look at reducing the amount of carbohydrate. Even if you think that's normal, you're still going to want to control how much carbohydrate, and certainly sugar, you know, really is going to be, it's going to be, when you start looking up the composition, you know, how much composition of food, there are lots of books, including Michael Murphy has a really good, did I say his name wrong? Is it Michael Murphy? Anyway, he has a really good book on foods, healing foods, which I don't agree with his conclusions in some cases because he tends to verge toward vegetarianism, which I think is fine for some people, but he doesn't discuss individual needs. So he's big on vegetarianism, which is fine for those for whom it works. But he does have many, many different indexes and things in the book that where you can look up carbohydrate contents of foods. You have to notice what the serving size is, though, because it's inevitably small. And you can look up protein content, nutrient content, amino acid profiles, all that kind of stuff. And he has good blurbs about the benefits and things of different foods. It's not miracle book, but it's one of the only books that I found to use as a reference book for looking up the component parts of foods, which may be useful if your blood sugars are over 100. Protein needs, as I said, oddly go up as you get older, not oddly, because you're dealing with repair and recovery. So it's generally better not to eat more than 6, if you're eating animal protein, or any protein, I suppose, not to eat more than, with animal protein, not to eat more than 6 ounces at a sitting. There are people who are larger, who are very active and very muscular, may be able to eat 8, but I would never have anybody suggest anybody normally eat 8 ounces of meat at a serving, because you can eat protein as a snack too, and you can have small servings throughout the day. What happens if you eat a very big serving of protein is that your detoxification pathways, which are trying to go toward glutathione in your liver to help you detoxify chemicals and toxins and things, get stuck at a step. And the step gets you stuck at homocysteine, which makes your blood very clotty. So about every 2 hours, you can have a snack with protein if you're still craving some, but and fat and whatnot. For vegetarians, there's less of a problem with getting too much protein at a sitting. It's harder to do that. And I'm going to discuss vegetarian how-to in a moment. But for meat eaters, there are, I should say, also with foods generally, there's lots of discussion in various books about Chinese medicine, some about Ayurveda and stuff like that, where you can look at what foods are hot, which foods are cold, which things stimulate, which is calming, what's moist and what's dry. Actually, the Dr. Shen Clinic, the owner of the Dr. Shen Clinic, who is actually a very nice Jewish man, has written a short book on Chinese medicine, which has a chart. There also are textbooks on Chinese medicine that you can get that are very interesting to read. Some of them stress the Taoist philosophy of Chinese medicine and break down the concepts of wind and all these other things. It's very surprising. But, you know, heating and cooling is going to have to do with foods with more protein or more heating. Cooling foods are vegetables and fruits. The more you cook something, depending on how you cook it, if you steam something, it doesn't change the heating quality very much, but if you fry it in at a high heat with lots of fat, it makes it warmer. Seeds are cooler than nuts, but any foods that are protein containing are going to be more heating, so that means grains as well. Stimulating and calming, some of that is kind of intuitive, but obviously drinking stimulants, doing things that are more calming, foods that are more calming, I think some of this is obvious. It also has to do with how spicy the food is and things like that, and how you cook them. So and it's going to have an effect on your gastrointestinal tract, very much so, to learn what you need. And I will say that it's rare that anybody needs only one of these qualities. Even if you tend to be hot and dry, or hot and moist, where you're boggy and you have lots of edema or something like that, it isn't the case that everything that you eat should only go in one direction. It's usually better if your diet is balanced. So somebody, for instance, who needs calming and cooling may find that they can overcool themselves too and have to have something warming. So sometimes maybe they do have, like I said earlier in the show, maybe if they're not a herpes patient or somebody who has a problem with arginine or overstimulation, can have a small amount of cocoa or cacao nibs, uncooked, less processed, raw ones, under certain circumstances, in balance, in small amounts when they're cold. So balance, 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 balance. And then, of course, we're going to need to go to fat. So one of the things with fats that's really important is also a question of balancing fats and eating fats that are minimal, not processed. I mean, if you've got any oil, any vegetable oil is going to be extracted. So you have to know whether or not it's probably prudent to know whether or not it was extracted with a solvent like hexane, or whether it's expeller pressed, and whether it was processed cold, since the heat damages delicate vegetable fats. And generally speaking, we tend to need more of the saturates, and then we need to add in omega-3 fats if we can, because the omega-3s are essential and not produced in the body. So fish oils, vegetarians can try using flax seed or one of these other things. Again, unless you're allergic. So you got to watch it, because flax is similar to, it can be an allergic food for some people. Notice how you feel thing. But the problem with these linoleic acids that the body can turn into an omega-3. If you eat fish oils, it's already a long chain omega-3. But the ones that need to be converted, if your blood sugars are over 100, you're not going to convert them to long chain omega-3. So again, who's the person? What's the need? What do they need? Fat is going to increase satiety. So this is why counting calories doesn't always work well, because fat can be upwards of 150 calories a tablespoon, but if you restrict the amount of fat, you don't feel satisfied. Actually, honestly, if you're more active and you eat more fat, you're not going to tend to put on weight. In fact, because it's a preferred fuel for the body that's fit. Fit body is going to burn fat, not glucose, so readily. So they're going to burn fat first and at rest. So the more fit you are, the more fat you can eat. So this is probably why, and if your blood sugars are high also, it's fat is the only thing you can't turn into sugar if you're diabetic. So diabetics are going to end up eating, who are controlling without medication, are going to end up eating at least something like 60% of their more calories out of fat and not gain weight. So this business of books that suggest eating more fat and not gaining weight, that only works if you're really eating a low-carb diet and you're active. If you just keep eating the same old diet with lots of carbohydrates in it and you add a whole slew of fat, you will gain weight. But it doesn't happen when you're more fit. And the saturateds are better because they're not damaged by heating, but vegetable oil is used cold. Can be very helpful, and for people, for instance, who tend to run, who need calming, for instance, and cooling, will find things like sesame oil very, very soothing. This is an Ayurvedic thing. So who are you? What do you need? Under what circumstances, etc.? We're going to need to take a brief musical break. This is Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm Lena Berman. I'm doing a solo show today that I'm calling Confusion, It's What's for Dinner. So stay put, stay where you are. We're going to have a little music and I'll return to the show. Confusion, It's What's for Dinner. Welcome back. This is Your Own Health and Fitness. I'm Lena Berman, and I'm doing a show alone today that I'm calling Confusion, It's What's for Dinner. We're talking about, or I'm talking, there's no we here, I'm not royal. I'm trying to give you principles so that you can begin to assess how you need to make food choices and decisions, what sorts of things to consider, because most of the, gosh, there's a lot of food recommendations out there, isn't there? And it seems to conflict a lot. And part of the problem is that there's an individual quality to how people eat and needs to be. So visit our website, yourownhealthandfitness.org, for information about this show and almost 700 other shows, free access to our recordings, all of them. And these shows, I should mention, are, I said, a stream. But in fact, all of our shows are free downloads. So you can own these. And they're all free, all of the old ones and the new one as well. We also have a free newsletter about upcoming shows. To contact us, send email to admin, A-D-M-I-N, @yourownhealthandfitness.org. And that's all spelled out. Your Own Health and Fitness, as always, is produced by Lena Berman and Jeffrey Fawcett, as you know. So let's go back to the show that I'm doing about Confusion, It's What's for Dinner. And for those that are just tuning in, I'm sorry. I did cover a bunch of stuff, but if you download the show later, you can go back and listen to it over and over and over again. So I'm moving on. After talking about fats, the next obvious place to go is when is it a good idea to consider a ketogenic diet or a paleolithic diet? Well, first of all, let's talk about the difference between the two. A paleo, forgive me, I'm going to have to take a quick sip of water here. Thank you. So, paleolithic diet is something that I used to call the hunter-gatherer diet. And when there's lots of old research about how people ate, how our ancestors ate, and a lot of it's been manipulated so that they can produce highly processed paleo foods, which are still highly processed. It's still powders and weirdness. But the basic concept is that it's a pre-agrarian, a pre-agricultural diet, and the reason for trying it, along with people have discovered it being a healthy way to eat and making it easier to maintain your weight, is because it eliminates foods that are allergenic, because most of the really highly, famously highly allergic foods came about with agriculture. So grains, grains are suspect because they can, and it does seem that they can be highly allergenic. Although I've noticed that people who are selling paleo products are also doing, talking about using alternative grains. And some of these grains are older than others. The Indians, Native Americans started producing these. And some of them are higher in protein and things. But A really strict paleo diet is an allergy elimination diet, basically. So it's really good for somebody who is completely confused about what they can eat and what they can't eat. So you eliminate grains, you eliminate dairy for a while. You do like a two weeks or something, or 3 weeks, to see whether eliminating obvious allergens, corn, like I said, grains, some of the really heavy if you are someone who tolerates starches, you get too thin when you eliminate starches like potatoes and sweet potatoes and yams, you might want to do sweet potatoes and yams and possibly potatoes, although they're a nightshade, but things that are less allergenic. And then you see, and you know, winter squash and whatnot, and you see whether it makes a difference for people who know themselves to be more carbohydrate sensitive, who get cravings when they eat starchy foods and sweet foods. This is an opportunity to eliminate those for a while and to raise the fat in your diet, good quality, unprocessed, using saturates as your base, because those are the ones that are most stable and they give you the satiety. And then you do vegetables that are not obviously allergic, and voila, after a month or so, you see whether your health picture really shifts. And I have seen remarkable, when I was practicing, you know, with people, I am not now, saw remarkable changes in people's gut health and brain health and moods and all kinds of stuff. That's paleo. Then there's ketogenic. And what ketogenic, one way to think about ketogenic is paleo might be just a basically good lifestyle change. For most people, keto is when there are real concerning symptoms and health issues. So, which might include obesity if you're really having a, you know, it's really serious. Certainly blood sugar and brain and neurological diseases, Parkinson's, MS, autoimmune diseases, can respond well to a ketogenic diet. Alzheimer's seems, especially if you start early with memory shifts and changes and whatnot, you can sometimes reverse these things. And these are diets where your carbohydrate intake is severely limited, and you're basically eating moderate, kind of normal, like 6 ounces of, you know, depending on your size and your activity level, maybe 6 ounces of protein is saying, again, they can be eaten again as snacks. But it's fat that really takes care of your energy. Remember, it's a preferred energy fuel, your energy and your satiety. And then you have small amounts of carbohydrates. So maybe at lunch you have, I don't know, a cup of cooked vegetables or raw vegetables, you know, some lettuce, half a cup of cooked vegetables. I've been corrected. Very small amounts of vegetables. It's good to have them though, you know, because you need to have, you can have all these great sulfur, but you're getting a lot of nutrients from, forgive me, it's vegetarians will hate this, but good quality meat has a lot of nutrients in it. So, but then you can do things like if you are non-allergic and you can tolerate dairy, you've got cheese, you've got cream. These are all ethically raised, preferably raw, if you can get hold of them. Again, money can be a consideration, but you do the best you can. You get the best quality you can. So what does it look like? It might be, again, depending on your allergic, how you are with allergies, it might be a 3-egg omelet with cheese, maybe as much as 2-3 ounces of cheese, maybe a tablespoon of hot sauce in there if you're somebody who needs warming and stimulating, maybe and some fermented, maybe some sauerkraut or a pickle or something with it, and that's breakfast. And then at lunch, perhaps, like I said, it's either lettuce, which is almost a freebie, although you can stuff yourself with anything and cause problems, but lettuce and some kind of high protein food, you know, animal protein is in this kind of a diet situation is going to be better. Although it is possible in books that talk about ketogenic diets, it is possible to do vegetarian, but it's much more difficult because your protein sources are coming from vegetable proteins, unless you're somebody that can handle dairy and eggs and you're not allergic, so you can eat them over and over again. But you again, you have small amount of vegetable matter. If it's cooked vegetables, it's maybe half a cup at the most, or you can have lettuce leaves, make them into you can make a sandwich, as some people used to say, and very small amount, you know, like I said, small amount of, but lots of fat, lots of cheese, lots of, you know, of whatever form of fat you can eat. People who are allergic can eat ghee, which is clarified butter. Anyway, but it's you're not so much soy, because soy, although it is high protein, is a highly allergic and also has an endocrinologic hit. It changes your hormones. It's estrogenic. Although some of the fermented soy products in small amounts could be used, I suppose. That's ketogenic, and the idea is that it puts you into a fasting state. Your body, now it isn't literally a fasting state. You're not actually fasting. You're not, catabolizing your body nutrients to do this. You're actually eating food, but it puts your blood sugar range down into a fasting state, and that controls diabetes. It controls neurological diseases. It stops them. It controls and sometimes can walk back Alzheimer's disease. It's absolutely essential for someone who is suffering from one of these problems. The brain. It's amazing, because what happens in the brain is if there is too much glucose, if there's too much blood glucose, too much starch and sugar in the diet, the brain actually begins to become hypo. It has low blood sugar. The sugar gets blunted to the brain if there's too much blood sugar in the system, in the blood and whatnot. It's counterintuitive, but it's true. And it looks as though the amyloid plaques come in as a protective device, and that they are less likely to be present in a brain that is using ketones for fuel. And this is not the same as ketoacidosis, which is supposed to be dangerous for diabetics. This is literally what makes people feel kind of good when they're fasting. This simulates a fasting state. And indeed, when you're doing a ketogenic diet, it's a good idea to stop eating earlier in the night, so that you get a bit of a fast between. So maybe you stop eating at somewhere between 3 and 5 o'clock at night, and then you don't start eating again till maybe 9 o'clock in the morning. So you get a longer. You get maybe, I'm not doing math fast right now, but you know you're getting maybe 14 hours. 12 to 15 hours of fasting in between, and that also helps to drive down blood sugars and protect the brain and whatnot. So that's a ketogenic diet, and it is being used increasingly for cancer as well. So there are an infinite number of books. We also have covered it on the show. Jeffrey's done some excellent interviews, so you can go back to our archives for that, yourownhealthandfitness.org. Okay, now there's another issue here, which is vegetarians. One of the things that's important to remember if you're going to try to be a vegetarian, and also I would not try to be a vegetarian if your blood sugars are over 100 unless you're willing to be really strict, and you can, and if you have really strong ethical feelings about being a vegetarian, which I support you in, then here's the deal. It's very important to keep your sulfur up. So this is true of everybody. Sulfur is very important. It's part of your detox pathways, and what we learned from Stephanie Seneff, we have several shows with her, that the body has protective mechanisms. In fact, heart attacks can increase the amount of sulfate, of a sulfated byproduct in the body. So sometimes a heart attack is the only way the body has of trying to protect you from dying in an extreme circumstance when the sulfate levels get too low. Now, we've got a problem here because we have, and I'm kind of jumping the gun on talking about something I wanted to talk about later, but again, mentioning the glyphosates, one of the problems with the glyphosates is that they knock out our capacity to metabolize sulfur-containing things. So people who have been sprayed with glyphosates or eating lots of glyphosates, and it can be cumulative and start to have problems with garlic and onions and cruciferous vegetables and whatnot, can't do it, the high sulfur foods. So this is your detoxification pathway. Your detoxification pathway is not about purging and fasting. It's about boosting your glutathione levels. And that cycle that produces glutathione relies on sulfur and methylation. So the reason I'm saying this is that vegetarians who are able to eat ethically raised pastured dairy and eggs, and again, be very careful with soy because, you know, for all the reasons, small amounts of fermented might work. But you've got to keep those sulfur-containing foods up. And it's one of the reasons why vegans have a harder time is because there's so much sulfur in animal proteins. But if you must, then remember also that your protein levels are coming from vegetable source, especially if you're vegan. So there are grains like brown rice and black rice and wild rice and quinoa and amaranth that do have a really complete complement of all of the amino acids, including the sulfur-containing aminos. And then if you are able to add, you know, if you're not being vegan and you can add a little cheese or eggs, all the more. So you can get a full complement of your amino acids, including the sulfur-containing ones. But you can also complete your proteins using these high amino acid-containing grains with beans and nuts. The problem here is that your carbohydrate content is going way up in this situation. So for a single meal, you may be eating as much as 100 grams of carbohydrate. And if your blood sugars are above 100, that's about, it's really, you shouldn't even be eating more than 100 a day without risking your brain. Once again, you're listening to Your Own Health and Fitness, and I'm Lena Berman. And today's discussion is confusion. It's what's for dinner. So we're talking about the extremely individual nature of dietary needs and how to assess yourself and what kinds of circumstances require different things. Remember, you can always download and keep for your very own this show forever and ever on our website, along with our over close to 700 other archive shows. Another thing about vegetarians in terms of the detox pathway. So here you are, you're being a vegetarian because it isn't. I'm not going to say eating meat is never perilous in terms of how polluted our environment is and how hard it is to get really ethically raised food and meat and how expensive it is and whether or not their fat is containing, you know, it's just, but vegetable fats too will contain more pesticides if they have them in it. But there, so anyway, so people make this choice and for moral reasons, which I totally support and understand. But you've got to keep your detox pathways up. And here you are eliminating some toxins and then your pathways don't work. So the stuff that you don't have control over or choice about, you're not able to process well. Well, here's a nice little trick. Vegans and vegetarians tend to be low in B12. So here's a trick. If you're not allergic to it and you don't have a huge distaste, I will tell you that nutritional yeast, rather than Brewer's yeast, is better tasting, but nutritional yeast has boatloads of B vitamins in it, including B12, and some proteins. So that's a great supplement for vegetarians. They also tend to be low in carnitine, which is very important for heart and muscle. And you can buy pharmaceutical-grade capsules, which do not have any animal products in them. But people who don't eat meat are low in carnitine, very important for the heart. So you can supplement with those. And then if you're doing a vegetarian diet, be really cautious about your carb intake and about your blood sugars. And, you know, if you're really confused about how well you're metabolizing carbohydrates, you can tell by how much you're craving sugar and carbohydrates. If you're a vegetarian who's craving sugar and carbohydrates all the time, that may be a problem. And if you can look at your body in the mirror and see what your composition is like, again, things work differently for different people. And then in terms of raw foods versus cooked foods, as near as I can tell, this is my opinion from reading things that I've read, is that human beings seem to jump right onto cooking when they could and found that they were more able to assimilate foods cooked rather than raw and had better assimilation. And then, again, studies how you set them up, blah, blah, blah. there's a sense that in some cases people do not thrive as much on raw food diets. Now, that's a big if, because it really depends on whether you make a career out of eating in terms of, and I don't mean this negatively, I mean this positively, that if you examine very carefully how you eat and you eat things in the right balance, in the right, you keep your protein content up and stuff. One of the tricks about raw versus cooked is that if you have horrible food allergies, one of the things that happens is if you, for instance, go get tested, like get an ELISA ACT test, that the antigens that they use to decide whether you're allergic, they expose your blood to these things, are all raw foods. Some people are allergic to raw foods. Some people react more strongly when they're cooked or combined with other foods. So, oddly enough, I have seen people who are allergic to raw carrots, and the cooked ones are fine, and vice versa. Some people do better with, for instance, raw nuts. You wouldn't think so, and you think, oh, phytates, you know, those block your mineral absorption. Well, you know, you get minerals from your greens, too. So, and vitamins, you take a multivitamin, that's the least you can do, and some extra vitamin C. Everyone should do that, I think. But raw nuts, for some people, are more cooling. So it goes back to the cooling, heating, stimulating, things like that. So things work better for different people. What if you've got a chronic illness? I've already mentioned herpes, arginine, lysine balance. And I think it's possible that other retroviruses may have this pattern where you get an outbreak when you do nuts and chocolate because of the arginine levels. So you can take extra lysine if that works. But there's other stuff, and there's chronic illness like Cephas and Lyme. And then again, you've got the issues of cooling and calming and moisturizing in terms of health, you know, if you look at it that way. So cooked soups and stewed foods, low allergen diets, fermentation is all going to be really, fermented vegetables are going to be very helpful for people with chronic illness. And food combining also, which is confusing because everybody has always for years and years and years combined things like nuts and grains and protein. And in food combining, you don't do that. But food combining is pretty magical if somebody's gut is really, really, really bothering them. So you don't have protein and starch in the same meal. You can have these things later. You certainly don't mix fruit with protein and grains. If you have nuts, you have those with fruit, but you don't, you know, and there are, you can look up these charts and find them. And it may be a good strategy for someone whose gut is in a roil. Blood sugars, boy, we've just talked about brain health, all of that stuff, ketogenic diets, diabetes. Once you switch into being diabetic all the time, and you, the older you get, the more difficult it is to control, even with diet and exercise. But ketogenic is the way to go, and exercises to maintain your metabolism and to retrain it. Mood, you got to look at GMO foods, food addictions, and food allergies. Leaky gut, you know, these allergies, the leaky gut idea is an inflammatory effect, and incidentally. It turns out that glyphosates were actually designed for as antibiotics. So glyphosates are killing all the gut microbes in the gut and causing lots of leaky gut and lots of food allergies in younger and younger people. So an elimination diet, removing obvious other exposures that increase inflammation like toxins and wireless and eating diets and that are low allergens. And then the gut, you know, the leaky gut, the glyphosates in the gut, antibiotics in the gut. And then all the things I said about cooling, calming, healing, you know, spices like garlic is really heating, fried foods heating, you know, again, all the wonderful things, all the books that are available. Toxicity, food is a delivery system for toxins. Where is your food grown? Are you getting food from the Central Valley? You might be surprised. Everything is coming from the Central Valley. So people still do better with foods that are labeled organic. Remember sulfur and sun. You will create lots of sulfur in your skin, not just vitamin D. Dr. Perro kind of skipped off on this. It's not just the vitamin D levels, which you need also, but actually producing sulfur in your skin. What is it called again? It's the cholesterol sulfate in your skin. So keeping a base tan, forget about this nonsense about sunscreens. It's just bad for you in many ways. Sun yourself. If you're fair-skinned, it's just 10, 15 minutes a day, but maintain a little base tan. Get that sulfur through your skin for everybody. So what have I forgotten? Is there anything? Oh, you know, people are going to ask me about acid alkaline. Use your head. Look it up. If you're having an acid stomach, there are foods that will make it, lots of protein foods, lots of grains will make it more acidic. Tea is going to be less acidic than coffee, but, you know, there you are. But, you know, there are charts. But my experience is that, again, these are tools like cooling and heating. Acid alkaline is a tool, and it will vary. And also, sometimes people need some acid, and sometimes they need alkaline. If you have an acid stomach an hour after you eat, take a tablet or a capsule of magnesium or some magnesium powder, and that will cool out your gut. So balance. There again are many, many, many resources. You know, there's, and the question also always comes up of whether to take vitamins. And yes, I really tell you to take vitamins. I have never changed my mind in the last 23 years and longer since I've been reading and doing work with people and things like that. Not working with people anymore, but Take a hypoallergenic multi. If you have other feelings about what you want to do food-based, I think you get lower amounts of vitamins. But if you're eating well and take care of yourself, multivitamin and some vitamin C, hypoallergenic if there's any question. So Jeffrey keeps holding fingers up to me, but I see that I have a few moments here, and I'm trying to think of what I might have. Incidentally, good to know that, again, with acid alkaline, fermented foods, you probably want to ferment them for a shorter amount of time if you've got a problem with acid in your acid gut and whatnot. The longer you ferment, the more acid it becomes, because they're acid-loving things. And remember that all this wonderful wireless stuff here, you know, the infrastructure, the Wi-Fi setups, all your devices, increase gut symptoms. They tend to increase gut symptoms. And I remember having people in my practice when I did that had horrible gut symptoms, and I told them to back off on the wireless and to put things, you know, turn things off and put them in shielded bags and plug things from the wall when they're not using them. And they got better. I think that just about wraps it up. So once again, assess yourself, think critically, Take the time to do some research and really pay attention to how you feel, because you're unique. No one else is like you. You're unique, and you need to be conscious of how you're unique and what you need. And I want to thank you for listening today. Our website is yourownhealthandfitness.org for information about this show and almost 700 other shows, free access to recordings, all of them as a free download, a free newsletter about upcoming shows. To contact us, send email to admin@yourownhealthandfitness.org. Your Own Health and Fitness is produced by Lena Berman and Jeffrey Fawcett. Now remember, being informed not only protects your health and your environment, it protects your freedom.
Why should the black man in America concern himself, since we've been away from the African continent for 400 years, 300 or 400 years? Why should we concern ourselves? What impact does what happened to them have upon us? Number one.
For news, information, and analysis about Africa and the African diaspora, tune in weekly on Mondays at 7 p.m. to Africa Today with your host, Walter Turner. Africa Today is your source for being up to date on Africa and African. Mondays at 7 p.m., Africa Today on your Pacifica radio station, KPFA 94.1 FM.
Nomi Prince, former Wall Street executive, current investigative journalist, has just brought out a new book, Collusion, How Central Bankers Rigged the World. She has that rare combination of deep knowledge and brilliant writing. Her new work throws unflinching light on the power players and dark conspiracies of international finance. Naomi Prince will speak on Sunday evening, May 6th, 7:30 at St. John's Presbyterian Church, 2727 College Avenue in Berkeley. There's wheelchair access at this KPFA benefit. Vilma V will host. Get tickets at independent bookstores or online at brownpapertickets.com. For Naomi Prince, May 6th.